the British Rail 10800 Diesel. Now, admittedly, the British are probably pretty close to the top in terms of train ingenuity and innovation. And at the time, dieselization was in full swing, so it seemed reasonable to produce a new switcher-style diesel to replace some of the steam trains that the railway was still using. And thus we have the 10800, which in its first 2 years of service gained an awesome, awesome nickname, the Wonder Engine. Now, what you're saying, but you just said this is a list of the worst trains on this list. How? That doesn't make any sense. And you are correct, because this is where you are missing the very, admittedly clever, British humor. The Wonder Engine refers to the daily query from the operators. I wonder if it will go today. The 10800 was plagued with unreliability. It just didn't work at all for at least the first 2 years of its service. And it was such a nightmare when you're trying to roll with an engine, you know, it has to move stuff around to keep the railway moving, and it just decides, I don't want to work today. It's just, I don't feel like it. Allegedly, the issue was down to its engine, which was just pure and simply unreliable. It broke if you looked at it the wrong way. Now, in the 10800's defense, it was later rebuilt with a new engine, and it did pave the way for later additions of a similar type of diesel, the Class 15 and Class 16, both of which use engines that were far and away superior to the 10800's original monstrosity. And that's kind of why I put it low on the list. Yeah, it had a really, really bad start. But it was an early diesel that was trying to be taken seriously, and it had to evolve over time. Pacer trains. Again, we're sticking with the UK for a moment. So, Pacer trains are an odd case, because you look at them and you say, huh, it just kind of looks like a city bus that you stuck on top of a train axle. And you would be alarmingly correct. That is exactly what they are. Now, admittedly, Pacers were not designed to be anything revolutionary. Quite the opposite, actually. The Pacer was designed to be a cheap replacement for the aging engines they were still using at the time, and give them extra time to get a more permanent replacement. Almost 40 years later, the poor British public have been forced to ride these awful, awful, awful things. They are some of the worst commuter trains ever devised, and that is purely based on the fact that they're cheap. This is footage of someone riding in one. Now, I've ridden on a lot of heritage railways, and I promise you, I have never, ever seen a train shake this badly that wasn't about to run off the rails. This is awful. I don't think the New York subway shakes this much, and nobody says a good word about the New York subway ever. It doesn't help that the interiors were also literally modeled like inner city buses, which is not made for lengthy travel comfort. So why, you may be wondering, why in the world have they been used for so long? Other than the little itsy-bitsy problem that they never really got around to developing a replacement, the fact was that the Pacers were, at the end of the day, cheap. Cheap to operate, cheap to replace, cheap maintenance costs, cheap everything. And yeah, the public hated them, but the railways were able to operate under trying times because these trains were so cheap. Thankfully, in recent years, they've finally gotten around to actually replacing these abominations and retiring them permanently to the, what I can only assume, outrageously polite praise of the British public. What is this thing? That is an excellent question. It is not a good steam engine. Quite the opposite. Under the white notation, which is how people generally identify steam engines and their layouts, this would be a 620. Namely, it has six unpowered leading wheels with two powered driving wheels. And I promise you, this design was ill-advised. Now, in its defense, this design came into fruition in 1849. So this is an old, old train design. And back then, there were a lot of really bad ideas when it came to train designs because the technology was still fairly new. But in this instance, I think they already kind of knew what the problem was because the designer really acknowledged it. Simply put, this train's issue is down to pure physics. It ran well, the firebox was a decent size, and its power output was alright for the time. The problem was that most of the weight of the engine was distributed on the unpowered 6 leading wheels. This is a problem because the only driving wheel has less of the engine's weight. This basically means that this engine's tractive effort, namely its ability to pull things, was virtually non-existent. It couldn't pull anything uphill, ever. Well, not ever. It could do it, but not nearly as quickly or efficiently as any other train riding the rails at the time. The only railroad that ever gave these engines a shot was the Camden and Amboy Railway in New Jersey, and that is purely because their particular line of rails had basically no grades. There were no hills to speak of. And on a level surface, this engine could do just fine for the most part. But at the end of the day, the design was horrifically flawed for basically any other rail line. SR Leader Class. Hey, British Railways, get off my list. Why are you still here? You take up more than half of my I'm not trying to pick on you, the UK. I'm an American, yes. And we threw the tea in the harbor, yes. But that was like over 200 years ago. And, you know, I'm a little over it. This isn't on purpose. It just happens that British Railways appears, based on my research, to have been slightly inept at their jobs. And introducing this thing... Well, to be fair, they never actually introduced it because it never got out of the experimental stage. But even at that point, this was ill-advised. Okay, so this is not what you think it is, and I promise you that. Maybe you look at this and you're like, oh, is that a diesel train? Or, oh, is that maybe it's an electric train? Oh, yeah, good guesses. This is a steam engine. I confused a lot of you. All of you are lost because this looks nothing like what you expect a steam engine to look like. But to be fair, that was the exact point of it. The Leader Class was an experimental articulated steam locomotive that was designed specifically to improve the ability and capacity for steam locomotives on British railway lines. It was developed and set into the experimental stage during a time when dieselization and electrification was rapidly taking over. Its main designer, Oliver Boulide? I'm probably pronouncing his last name completely wrong, I apologize, was already an innovative engineer known for developing many successful trains. And he really liked steam trains, and he really thought that steam could be developed and compete with both diesels and electric. In his defense, he's not completely wrong. Steam had some advantages, it still does. It's just that diesel and electric were, at the end of the day, cheaper to run. But he thought there was a way to make steam that way too. And the Leader was meant to do that. It did not. It did not at all. It was a disaster. For one thing, designing a completely different looking steam train, it was meant to look like a diesel to compete with the new, sleeker designs of the modern trains, meant you had to completely rearrange how steam engines generally are. This meant working from the ground up with new parts, more expensive materials, and all sorts of stuff. In addition, the train had to be completely enclosed, which is a little awkward when it's designed to work with only 2 crew members on board, and the fireman and the driver, normally sharing the same space on any classic-style steam engine, were now completely separated, and the fireman was forced to work in a tiny cramped room that he could only access by crawling through a crawl space! I know it's an experimental design, but come on, someone had to have said something about that! Not only is that just inconvenient, but it's a horrific safety hazard! If anything went wrong, anything, the firemen only had a handful of ways to get out. At least with classic steam trains, any crew could just jump. They might get hurt, but a lot of them lived doing this exact method. That was not an option on the Leader. And the worst part is that none of the issues I've mentioned so far had anything to do with the project's cancellation. It was down to, well, cost effectiveness. Like I said, it was expensive. But then, it didn't perform very well in its tests. It just didn't have the output they expected. And steam trains are very, very good at overall power output. That's just what they do. That's one of their best traits. Diesels, electric locomotives, especially at the time, couldn't necessarily compete with that. What they had, though, was cost effectiveness. The Leader wasn't cost-effective, and it wasn't very power-efficient either! It wasn't doing anything right! So yeah, they canceled that project. Which is a shame, because I do think Steam should have, and probably could have, been developed to a state that would have been more modern, and maybe we'd see more Steam trains on the tracks today. But I'm probably biased because, let's be real, any heritage railway lover loves steam engines. They just choo-choo, come on, you gotta love it. Not you! Nobody liked you. You didn't do a good job, I'm sorry. You tried your best. It was not to be. The Soviet Union will never cease to amaze me in their abilities to produce both the best and the worst things ever. They are so good at the extremes. Speaking more specifically, the Soviets really, really liked big, big things. You want the biggest plane in the world? You got that. Biggest helicopter? Yeah, they had that too. They just really liked doing that. Now, they didn't have the biggest train ever, but they had a pretty big one. It was known as the AA-20-1, and it was an insane 414-4 locomotive. That is, I can't stress this enough, 4 leading wheels, 14 coupled driving wheels with 7 axles in a rigid frame, and 4 training wheels. That is insane. Now, admittedly, locomotives with rigid frames that were this big did have some limited success over here in America. Union Pacific ran 412-2s for years, and the Soviets just wanted to do more of that, but bigger. But the Soviets also ignored some of the slight flaws with a rigid-style locomotive that was that alarmingly large. To begin with, even Union Pacific engines, which again, fairly successful, were maintenance nightmares. And they weren't really designed to do what the Soviets seemed to think. See, a large rigid frame like this, well, it has to turn at some point. The thing about the Union Pacific Railroad is that it had a lot of straight shots and a lot of flat terrain to work with. Whereas the Russian railway did not have that quite as much. And even if it did, it didn't, the AA-20 had a sneaking little teensy-weensy problem that it was just way, way, way too heavy. Not only did its huge weight sometimes damage the actual lines, but then it wrecked the points of the switches it passed over. Also, it was too big to fit on turntables, because of course it was. And it was somehow too powerful for the couplers they used, and if that all wasn't bad enough, the firebox was too small. See, steam engines, have to make steam. And naturally, the firebox produces the heat to make the steam from the water. It all makes sense. Because of its immense size, the brilliant designers completely and woefully underestimated how big of a firebox they need, making it so that the AA-20 basically never, ever, ever got up to full steam. And on the rare occasion they could actually manage to pull it off, it wasn't able to do that for very long, and naturally, it was also damaging the rails. As it turns out, running a big, heavy, weirdly powered locomotive over damaged lines and switches, risks derailments. Which happened. Often. The AA-20 was never, ever used in proper service. It did make a publicity trip to Moscow in 1935, but then they just kind of threw it into storage and they scrapped it in 1960, and they didn't state that publicly. Because it just served as a political tool. It was big and scary and, whoa, Russia, yes! But it was really, really bad at its job. I'm not trying to bash Russia. They made a lot of great engines over the years. But the AA-20, in my opinion, was the worst ever. Ever. Till next time, this is Darkness, an Abiduella fond farewell.